And good morning. So good to see you. Welcome to the house of the Lord today on this second Sunday of the month of June. Looking forward to just a wonderful day. Had a great 8:30 service, great Sunday schools, new members classes. So excited for what the Lord has for us this morning. You can see we're ready for Vacation Bible School and excited about that this coming week. Congregational singing, it is the joy of the church on this earth. It will be the joy of the church when we are together at the throne of grace in heaven. And a wonderful song to sing of the wondrous story of our Savior and His giving of His life for us. Stand if you would this morning. Let's begin by singing the wondrous story. I hope and pray you know it in your heart today.
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. How He left His home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. I was lost, but Jesus found me, found a sheep that went astray. Through His loving arms around me, drew me back into His way. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. Days of darkness still come o'er me, sorrow's path I often tread. But the Savior still is with me, by His hands I'm safely led. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. He will keep me till the river rolls its waters at His feet. Then He'll bear me safely over where her loved ones I shall meet. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea.
Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this morning and the fact that we can indeed rejoice in the wondrous story that Christ was willing to come and die for each and every one of us. Father, thank You that it is because of that redemption story that we can gather and celebrate and worship Your holy name. Father, thank You for the liberty that we have in Christ. Thank You for the liberty that we have from sin because of Christ. And Father, it is that truth that we declare this morning and that we rejoice because of the love of God in us. Father, I pray that You fill Pastor with Your Spirit, allow him to speak freely. But Lord, above all, allow us to receive with gladness. Father, that anyone who would be here today that has not humbled themselves and received the gift of love that God can only provide, that today would be that day of salvation. Meet with us in a great way, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Please turn around and greet those around you.
As you come back, remain standing. I love this little chorus. It brings about an awe-ness to the Lord Jesus. I trust as you stand and sing to praise to the God whom all praise is due, that you will stand in awe of Him and who He is and what He's done in your life. Lift your voice now. Do the best you can. I hope it's a moment of reverence.
You beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. You are beautiful. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension. Like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you.
Amen. Be seated. I hope and pray that you're in awe of him today as you think about who he is and what he has done in your life. So good again to see you on this Lord's Day. Welcome, church family. Trust you've had a wonderful week. Looking forward to another week of serving the Lord. If you're visiting with us today, we're excited to have you, especially if it's your first time with us. In the pew in front of you, there's a connection card. If you'd be so kind as to reach out, grab that card. On the way out, stop by the welcome desk there, exchange that card for a gift, a tumbler, use in your house and your car. And as you use it, pray for us, think about us. And as we have your card, we will do the same for you. While they're doing that, let me just make some announcements now. Of course, it's a special day today as we recognize our graduates. And we'll do that in just a little bit. Those that have graduated high school, college, and postgraduate work, we have that to recognize today. After this service, I would say this service will be done by 2:30 for sure. Just seeing if you're awake. Some of you are awake there. We have a special meeting for those parents that their kids are going to camp. And we have a tremendous amount of number of students going to camp. Some of them are new students this year. So that meeting will take place, I believe, here in the auditorium. We were going to meet in another room, but I think we've overgrown that. So if you'll just hang out here in the auditorium, Brother Simeon has some information that he would want to give to you. You can see that we're ready for Vacation Bible School tomorrow all throughout the building. Covet your prayers, church family, as this is our opportunity to evangelize. This is also an opportunity for people to get to know Plantation Baptist Church. God does a lot of work through children, and probably annually we reach people with the Lord, new people to come to church, and so an important time. If you're working Vacation Bible School, make sure you're here good and early and come ready to serve, come ready, spirit-filled, and ready to be a blessing. Of course, Vacation Bible School runs Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So because of that, there'll be no Wednesday night Bible study this week. No midweek service. We'll be fully consumed and concentrated on Vacation Bible School. So we'll pick back up on the 22nd. You can see all kinds of announcements that are in the bulletin as far as the kids going to camp. Zara Joy Cuddy is going to be married on July 2nd here at the church. She wanted to let you know, and of course, you're invited to that. Those of you that know the Joy Cuddy family, will be a great blessing for your presence. And then we go all the way into the month of July. I wish I could take the time to tell you about all of the wonderful things that God is doing and the answers to prayer. We've had just a wonderful week serving the Lord. I do want you to put one name, one family name on your prayer sheet today, Jose Zarazua. Jose and his wife Martha attend our church and their children, and Jose's mother was coming down to visit from Ocala and got deathly sick, turned around, went home, and she did go home to be with the Lord. It was a shocking moment in the life of the family, and so the funeral for Martha, his mother and his wife had the same name, Martha. Don't get them confused. Sometimes that happens. And this is his mother that passed. And we will have the service on Tuesday at Forest Lawn off of Copens Road up there in the Margate area. So please pray for the Zarazua family if you would. I know the importance of music, the importance of congregational singing, what it does in our hearts to prepare us for the preaching of the Word of God. And I'm preaching today a message from Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1. In the beginning, God. In the beginning, Elohim. If you can believe the very first verse of Genesis, you can believe the entire Bible. The very first verse of Genesis will refute the philosophies of our world. The message today will go from a look back to the creation of God to a look to the moment as to why the world is so messed up. It's going to be a tremendous moment as we realize the true and living God. Why do I say that? Because you're getting ready to sing a song that's going to present you for worship, as I worship you, Almighty God. And then you're going to do three verses of the great hymn of How Great Thou Art. Oh, there is no God as great as our God. If you are a graduate, a high school graduate, or a college graduate, or a postgraduate, when we start singing, and when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, I would ask you to come down to the front row, stand and be ready. We would love to take a moment to acknowledge you as you present your graduation moment to us, and just rejoice in you, with you, and all that God has done. Stand if you would, church family, as we worship the Almighty God.
Stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. Then at the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he He bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art.
Amen. Be seated if you would, please. Wonderful job singing. It's an awesome opportunity we have today to acknowledge those that have successfully completed their course of education and have graduated. And we had three at 8:30, Malik and Leon, who had graduated high school, and my daughter Casey, who had graduated college. And I see that we have more here this morning. And so I'm going to break it down this way, high school, college, and postgraduate. If you graduated high school at this time, would you come to the platform if you graduated high school? Come on, I know some of you are right here. There should be more of them. They're hiding. Here they come. And wonderful. Anybody else out there graduated high school? Some of you have tried 3, 4, 5 times, and you're acknowledging that. All right, I want them to give their name and where they graduated from and what they plan to do as they understand God's direction for them. If not, then they can just simply say, waiting on the Lord to provide that direction. And I hope and pray that you're blessed by this moment. And so let's begin with Anid.
Hi, my name is Anid Clarizier. I graduated from Plantation Baptist Christian School. I am pursuing a degree in biology at Nova Southeastern University. Thank you.
Hello, my name is David DiMello. I graduated from West Broward High School. I'm going to FIU and majoring in health service administration, and my end goals are becoming a dentist.
I'm Gunnar McGahee. I graduated from Archbishop McCarthy High School. I'm going to Reinhardt University and studying sports studies.
Hi, good morning. Oh, sorry. My name is Isabella Vickers, and I graduated Archbishop McCarthy just like Gunnar. And I will be attending UCF in the fall, and I will be on the preclinical track majoring in biology.
All right, stay standing right there, and proud of all of them, and excited for that. Let's go with our college graduates. You graduated with a bachelor's degree. I knew I was looking for you guys over there, and here they are. These are our two college graduates. Of course, we will let the lady go first.
Good morning. My name is Erica Marion. I graduated with my bachelor's degree from Bob Jones University. And I got my degree in health sciences, specifically focusing on public health and global health. And right now I am job hunting, so please pray for me because it's really stressful. And I will be getting married within the next few months.
Sorry. Hi, my name is Thomas Williamson. I graduated from Liberty University with a bachelor's in computer science, and I'm pursuing my master's in August, and I'm already married, and my wife is sitting back there. She needs some praise, too, for going through with three kids. It was really rough, but got through it. And, you know, hopefully that's a testimony for anyone here who's never finished. Maybe you can do what I did. Though it was hard, it was worth it.
Amen, Thomas. Wonderful. I appreciated him giving you that recognition, Radine. If he didn't, I was going to. And Erica is getting married in the future, but she doesn't know the day in which she's getting married. I'm just kidding you on that. She didn't give the date there. By the way, so you know who she's marrying, I'll ask Ruben to stand so we can put two and two together. This is her fiancé here. They'll be getting married in January. Wonderful. All right, and we have a post graduate amongst us, and I will let him tell who he is, what God has enabled him to do, and I know we'll rejoice with this.
Yeah, many of you know me. I'm Nick Zarella, my wife Lorena. I just graduated from Pensacola Christian College with a doctor in ministry, and my wife and I, my family, are getting ready to go to the mission field of Japan this coming October, so I know my wife will really look forward to you calling her Dr. Lorena. She got this degree, so praise the Lord for that.
We know the truth, Lorena, and it is Dr. Lorena, that's for sure. Don't you love to just celebrate accomplishment? Feels good to do that. Let me encourage, if you've been thinking about going back to school, you should take Thomas's encouragement. Let me encourage all of you that were thinking about dropping out of college, stay the course, finish. Rarely do I ever meet anybody that quit going to school that didn't regret it later. Stay the course. It's hard, but when you cross the finish line, it's worth it. If you're in high school, you want to get your high school degree. I know you can get other degrees and get the education when you get over, but stay encouraged. Surround yourself with people that will be there for you, praying for you, and cross those courses. There is something to be said about graduating. There is. And just let that be a little bit of encouragement there to you as well. All right. I want you to meet one other young man. He's not a graduate, but I want to include him in our prayers because he is a corporal in the United States Marine Corps, and he had a moment to come home. He's been stationed overseas. He's receiving another assessment out in California. This is the young man that I told you started a Bible study and was able to see another Marine come to saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he wears the uniform and protects our freedom. And he's seated right down here. His name is Vaughn. Vaughn, I'm going to ask you to stand. Welcome our brother home and our Marine home. Thank you, Brother Vaughn. Just got promoted to corporal and called me and said, Pastor, it's a big responsibility to lead Marines. Pray for me. And so we want to pray for all of our young men and women serving. Okay, let's have our prayer of dedication for these folks. Men, if you'll get ready for our offering, and then we'll have our trio and have our message. Heavenly Father, just the joy of the room is wonderful as we are able to applaud and cheer and recognize and thank you for each person that's standing on this stage. Lord, I know them, proud of them. I know that many of them had many difficulties and things to overcome, but they stayed the course. And Thomas even said, you know, I went back. And you're so faithful, God, and you're so kind, you're so merciful. I just praise you for that. Lord, those that have graduated high school, I trust that you will protect them as they go into the colleges and the universities of our nation. Lord, those are educational systems that do not always stand on the word of God, a very dangerous time, vulnerable time. I trust that these young people would remember the things that they've been taught, that they would apply them, that they would remember that God's word is true and powerful, and it cannot be taken away from, and so may they stand on your holy word. Lord, I think about those that have graduated college and they will begin into life and exciting life and a new plan and a new direction. And Lord, it is something that we wait on you for and can be scary, but you have us. You are a good shepherd. You're the great shepherd. You lead us in those paths of righteousness. And may we just stay faithful, trusting you. And God, thank you for Brother Nick and his accomplishment now. And Lord, he has been as much education, but all of that education he has submitted to the supreme blessing, and that's the power of God upon his life. As you send him and his wife to Japan as missionaries, oh, may they go with the wonderful blessing and prayers of God's people. Lord, I think about Vaughn, and I think about our other men and women that are serving in our United States military. We pray a hedge of protection around him. Thank you he could be home today in his church. Thank you for the way you're using him for the cause of Christ. Protect and keep him. May he feel from this moment forward the prayers of a church family as we have a face and a name and a person that we can take to the throne of grace. God, I'm tasked today with preaching probably the most foundational verse in the whole Bible. In the beginning, God. And so I pray, Holy Spirit of God, that you would fill me and control me. Help me to preach with power and authority and with wonderful present day application. When we leave here today, may we leave here believing there is no God like thee, the true and living God. We love you. Bless the offering. Bless the offertory now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you as you give. God bless you as you make your way. We have a gift for you guys right here. Brother Simeon will hand out the gifts. So funnel by him, if you would please, back to your seat. And a gift, depending on what school you graduated from, and should have your name on there, and be a blessing. All right, our trio is a song entitled The Great Divide. It speaks about that wonderful divide between lostness and salvation that Christ has provided. God bless you, ladies, as you sing.
Bridge to cross the great divide. cross to bridge the great divide. Oh, there's a bridge to cross the great divide. A way was made to reach the other side. The mercy of the Father cost the Son his life.
Thank you, ladies. I was thinking the whole time that divide would not be crossable without the cross of Christ. I trust that you know and have crossed that divide on Christ's cross. Take your Bible, if you would, please. And again, this week, would you make your way back to page number one? Page number one in your scripture should bring you to the book of Genesis. It should bring you from the book of Genesis to chapter number one, verse number one. Thank you for being in the house of God today. Thank you for loving the Lord. Thank you for bringing your scripture. Thank you for having a heart to hear God and a desire to grow in His Word. How the World Got So Messed Up. This is the title of our series. This is a title that the Lord laid on my heart for a direction to spend some time in the next few months in the 11 chapters, the first 11 chapters of the book of Genesis. Since I have been studying and preparing for this series, I am very sensitive to the words messed up. I hear them in Publix. I hear them sometimes on the television. I hear them in conversation with other people as they're talking around me. And I was encouraged over the course of this week by just understanding that I'm not the only person in the world that thinks the world is messed up. There are others. Whether you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ or not a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, whether you acknowledge the Word of God as to what it is or not, I'm hearing people say that's messed up. And that thought has struck my heart, and so I wanted to help Plantation Baptist Church and help myself understand and deal and live inside of a world that is messed up. You and I, according to the scriptures, are to shine as lights in this world. We are to reflect the light of the Lord Jesus. We are to live each day with the joy of the Lord. We are to live with peace. We are to live with purpose. We are not to live with our head stuck in the sand or with a pessimistic point of view, or just a view that thinks that there's no help or no salvation for mankind. We know that in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I would submit to you that we have begun a journey on some of the most hated part of the Bible that there is. Yet, I do believe if we are going to understand this world in its present day, we must go back to the beginning of our world, to the beginning of time. We must go back to Genesis chapter 1 through chapter 11 and understand how God made the world, why God made the world, what was going on when God made the world, God's plan for the world, so we can understand the world in which we live. Last week, as we looked at the book of origin or the book of beginning, we found all types of things that you and I deal with in our life, everything from our government to our sexuality, to the understanding of creation, to the understanding of order and complexity, to the understanding of the universe. All of these things that seem to be cultural topics, we find the origin of that in the book of Genesis. Now, I don't know about you. I think I understand my audience. They tell us as speakers that we should understand our audience, so let me just check. Our audience today believes that this is the eternal Word of God. This is absolute truth. okay? We understand that there is no book on the planet higher than this book. Every other book, every other textbook, every other magazine, every other news article, every other opinion, every doctoral thesis, every other document will one day bow down to the authority of the Word of God. Okay? So if we're going to understand that as a foundation, it gives us a biblical perspective to understand the world around us. My responsibility today as I preach the message is it will be a little bit intellectual. I know that will surprise you coming from me, but there will be a little bit of intellectualism there. There will be a little bit of just lecture, a little bit of laying of groundwork. But I promise you, as I get to the end, I will be able to take the message and the truth and plop it right in your lap. And when you go home and you turn the television on, you're going to be able to see what Pastor Hunter was preaching about today, and you're going to be able to make biblical application in your life. Having said that, would you please make your way to Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1. The Bible says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." Let's read it together out loud. We did this last week. We'll do it again. 1, 2, 3. "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." I want you to read it. I hope your Bible says heaven and not heavens. Okay. Heavens is in verse number 4. "In the beginning, God created," look very carefully, "the heaven and the earth." Pastor, my Bible has a plurality there. You'll understand at the end of this message that it's a singular. All right, let's do it again. Let's get it. "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." I would submit to you that the first verse of the Bible is the foundational verse of the Bible. I would submit to you that if a person can believe the first verse of the Bible, a person will have no problem believing the rest of the Bible. Pastor, is that because the first verse of the Bible is hard? The first verse of the Bible is no more difficult to believe than any other verse to believe. For this truth, you need the book of Hebrews. So hold your hand here and go to Hebrews chapter number 11, if you would please. I want you to be able to see from the book of Hebrews the key when it comes to believing the Word of God. You should have had this passage in your Sunday school a few weeks ago, and should be a reminder to you. Look, if you would please, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 3. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 3, the Bible says, through, what's that word, class? Faith. Not intellect. Not proof. Not evidence, not history, not something tangible. Turn me down just a little bit. I hear myself up here, please. Through faith. What is faith? Faith is believing God. Verse number 3, please. Through faith we, what's that word? Understand. Not by a textbook, not by science, not by a professor, not by the History Channel. For the believer, through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of the things which do appear. Well, Pastor, does that mean you're just wishing and hoping? Go to verse number 1, if you would, please. Now, faith is the, what's that word? Starts with an S. The substance, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now, faith is the substance, so faith is substantial. It's not weak, it's not pathetic, it's not small, it's substantial. Of things hoped for, it is the, what class? Evidence of things not seen. So faith, which cometh by the word of God, has the ability to build in our life substantialness and evidence. So through faith, we understand all of God's word is to be believed by faith. All of it. Well, Pastor, I believe part of the Bible, but I don't believe some of the Bible. Then you don't believe all the Bible. This is a unified book. Faith is where what comes into play in believing or trusting the word of God. Back to Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Some introductory remarks about the way that the Bible opens. The Bible opens in the very first verse of Genesis with no attempt to prove the existence of God. Never does the Bible have to prove the existence of God. It just declares the existence of God. The Bible does not prove, makes no attempt to prove. It simply takes for granted the eternal existence of God and begins with the eternal God creating physical things. In the beginning, God, Elohim, is the Hebrew word. It's used 2,500 times there in the scripture. It's used all throughout the book of Genesis. In the beginning, God. That word God there in its Elohim form is a plural majesty with a singular verb. It's called a uniplural noun, which means there is one God, but our one God has three persons. So in the beginning, Elohim, God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Pastor, are there three gods? No, there's three persons in the Godhead, but there's one God. Okay. In the beginning, God. How old is God? Think about that. How old is God? Let me ask you another question. When did God begin? How old is God? And when did God begin? I would submit to you that God is eternal. And the Bible would teach you that he had no beginning and he has no end. Okay? So work your brain here just a moment. Eternal God? No beginning? Pastor, that just can't be. My friend, that's exactly how it can be. Pastor, it doesn't make sense for God to just always be. I mean, he has to have a beginning, right? I mean, come on, that doesn't make sense. I'm a rational person. A rational person understands there has to be a beginning. Okay, right. You're a rational person, but you're also a created person. People who struggle with the fact of the eternity of God or that God had no beginning or no end, it proves that you and I are not God. It proves that we are not equal to God. It proves that you and I are finite. It proves that we do have limits. It proves that our mind and our rationale can only go back to the moment of creation. They can be developed from there. They can grow from there. But there's a physical and a rational and a thought world. But when it comes to the eternal world, we're not eternal. We were created, which proves that we're sinners who need to be saved. Think about this for a moment. God is eternal. You were created. Just think about it. There was a time you didn't exist, and God made you. There you are, ugly as can be in your mother's womb. Pastor, isn't my baby beautiful? Forgive me, but I've never seen a beautiful baby, even my own included. They all look like space aliens to me. So God created, right? I'm created for a season on this earth. Eternal God. That's interesting. Man thinks he's God. Man acts like there's no God. Man curses the true and living God. Man thinks himself to be something special. We were created. And the Creator, making a creation, has purpose for the creation. But the creation is never greater than the Creator. So if you can believe that God is eternal and that God created you, then you can believe that God sent his son into the world to die for your sin. This word created is precious and powerful. It's the Hebrew word bara, B-A-R-A. It speaks of, and the only when it's used in the scriptures, it's always only describes the work of God. In the beginning, God created. This word created cannot be used of humanity. Humanity can make things. Humanity can form things. But humanity has never created anything. And how audacious arrogant it is to think that we create. Well, I created those children. No, you didn't. You may have made them and formed them. You didn't create them. We say stupid things like, just, I got to create a little time in my schedule. You can't create time. You move and you form. This word created is spoken of God, and it's used of only God, because only God can create. And the description of this is this: calling into existence that which had no existence, which means out of nothing, God created. You and I, we create things, and we take matter, and we take material, and we form, and we shape, and we build skyscrapers in humanity. We build certain things, and we step back, and we say, I created them. No, you didn't. You used what God created to shape and to form, but no human can bring something out of nothing. Okay, now think about this, because people hate God, and people don't want God. And people think they're on the same level of God. Well, let's see you create something out of nothing. It's interesting. The work of making and forming consists of organizing already existing materials into more complex systems. God's creation speaking into existence something whose materials had no previous existence. My friends, there was nothing until God said, let there be. Think about that. Because if you would believe that, then you would want to worship God. You would never stiffen your back to God. You would humble yourself and bow down to God. Out of nothing, God created. No wonder the Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof and the people therein. God can claim ownership of all of the world because God created the world. Amen? Okay, we're getting there. What did God create in verse number one? Heaven, earth, in the beginning. Heaven, the Hebrew word there is the word space. Earth, the Hebrew word there is matter. In the beginning, time. So in verse number one, in the beginning, God. You could say it this way, the transcendent, omnipotent Godhead called into existence space, mass, and time. We would take those three words and we refer to them as the universe. The universe is actually a continuum of space, matter, and time, and one needs the other too. So in the beginning, God created. Now, don't think about the galaxy and the stars. They came on day number four. In the beginning, out of nothing, he created space. We're in a space. There's inner space, outer space, atmospheric space. Praise God he committed or created personal space. Space! I know Elon Musk wants to take you there. Go! But you're only going there because God made it. Don't tell me God is weak and pathetic. Our God is awesome. Space, matter, time, a universe. When you read the Bible, you find that God created these things for his pleasure. You read that God created these things for good and glory. You read that God wanted a relationship with his creation. And when you think about a messed up world today, wants nothing to do with the God who created them. Why is this so important? This is so important because Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, refutes much of the world's philosophies today. I would submit to you that belief determines behavior. I told you last week, what you believe about your origin will reflect in the purpose of your life. The philosophies today that the world holds are anti-God. We're going to talk about them. The philosophies that the world holds and understands are used to attack God today. The philosophies of the world deal with the behavior of the world today. You want to know why the world's so messed up? I'll give you seven reasons. And all of them can be refuted from Genesis chapter 1. First off, let's deal with atheism. You know what God says about an atheist? The fool has said in his heart, no God. Atheism, rampant, one of the fastest growing philosophies in the world is atheism. You want to read a sick, messed up book of the Bible? Read Judges. You want to read about a people who did horrific and heinous and wicked things? The nation of Israel. When you read the book of Judges, there was an atheistic philosophy that went through the people. And the Bible refers it this way. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. And God would send the judges into the nation to correct them. Our world is messed up today because of an atheistic belief that denies the existence of God. It denies belief in God. It allows humanity to live life without any type of God morality, any type of God prerequisite, any type of God responsibility. And every man can do that which is right in his own eyes. So if I want to take your wife, I can take your wife. If I want to murder your child, I can murder your child. If I want to steal what you have, I can do it. Because there is no God. The law won't punish me. Nobody's going to do anything about it. Not even God. I don't even believe in a God. So the way I'm going to live my life is just how I want to live it. I would say the world's pretty messed up. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1, refutes atheism because it teaches that all things were made by a true God. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. If you are an atheist in this room, you need to listen to the message today because a true God created you. Let's talk about pantheism. Pantheism, Pastor? Where'd you get these big words? You've been in the encyclopedia? Watch how I drop pantheism in your lap. Pantheism, the belief that the universe is God. There's no true God. There's no being God. Everything is God. The tree is God. People are God. Pantheism would tell you that the substance and forces and laws of the universe are the moving of God. And the way that we worship the universe is we just give in to the energy of the universe. From pantheism, you get things like pansexual. Now, here's a word that if you're over 60, you probably don't know. Here's a word that if you're 40 to 60, you're not paying attention to. But here's a word that the youth of our nation are being dominated by. It's one thing for Hollywood to come out as homosexual. They've run their course on that. Now it's not too big. Now they have to come out as pansexual or all these other things. Pansexual is that I'll sleep with you no matter what your biological sex is, no matter what your gender or what your gender identity is. I don't care. I'm open to everything. As long as I'm in love with your spirit and the universe, then we can have a bond. I promise you, if your child is 18 or under, they know it. Not my kid, Pastor. Yeah, your kid. I promise you, they can call out the cultural people that have come out and that celebrate this way. Pantheism. The universe is just God. There's no true creator. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1, says that a transcendent God created the universe. The universe is space, matter, and time. God is eternal. Let's talk about polytheism. Polytheism, the belief in more than one God. Well, of course there has to be more than one God. I mean, you can't just be so narrow-minded as to have one God. Polytheism is running rampant in our culture today. And by the way, just let me say this. The reason that there is not an awakening to the Lord Jesus Christ is because of polytheism. If you believe that there's more than one God, there's no way you would ever want Jesus. Why in the world would a polytheistic person ever want Jesus? If you believe in there's more than one God, you've probably created gods or assigned to gods, and all of those gods are going to tell you you're perfect. You're good. You should do what feels right. There should be no rules to you, no morality to you. Why would you ever want a God that says you're a sinner and if you don't receive me, you're going to face the judgment that I have? Why would you ever want a God that would put morality or barriers upon you? Polytheistic people hate Jesus Christ because he exposes them as to who they are. They don't see what he could make them as, and they choose gods that fit their life. And so instead of submitting to the true and living God, we've got to create polytheism. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1 says, one God created all things. That one God is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh to the Father but by him. That ought to get an amen from us, right? So if you believe in many gods, you must believe in many heavens, or you believe in many roads to heaven. So anybody that says, well, there just can't be one way to be saved, they're polytheistic. So your dad or your child who doesn't believe there's one way to be saved is polytheistic. That's in our lap. Let's talk about materialism. That matter, nothing exists except matter. No spiritual life. All the happiness in the world is what I possess or have. The Bible would teach that matter had a beginning. Matter is not a deity. Matter is not God. God created matter. Let's talk about dualism. Dualism is exactly what it sounds like. Two supreme opposed powers, either gods or something else, that caused the world to exist. Here you have a God of good and a God of evil. The Buddhist religion teaches this. You go into a Buddhist temple, you'll find they have a building for the good God and a building for the evil God. This is where you get that philosophy of good and evil in the world. I want you to know something. There's no such thing as an evil God equal to the true God. There was not a good God who created and an evil God who destroyed. There's one God. One God. Now, Satan is the God of this world, but Satan himself was created. Our culture has exalted evil to the same Godhead as the true and living God. Dualism. By the way, dualism is destroyed in Genesis 1:1 because God was alone when he created the world. Let's talk about humanism. Humanism, the value and goodness of human beings. Humanism would teach you that you are your own God. Humanism would deny that of an afterlife. And humanism would say that the way that you perceive morality is the starting point for your righteousness. Your truth is your truth. Humanism would teach that if I'm going to have meaning to my life, then that meaning has got to have, by seeking happiness in this life, which means I don't have a God of holiness and justness and mercy and grace. I don't have a word of God with power and authority. I am God. Now, I don't recommend this, but I was researching for the message, and I found a music video of somebody named Halsey. I don't know her. I know she's demonic and probably demon-possessed, and sings a song, I'm not a woman, I'm a God. And you had women in a tub circled with a satanic symbol singing, we are a God. That's everywhere in our public education system in our youth. That's everywhere in television. That's everywhere in our culture. You are your own God. Whatever your morality is fine. You just be you. Genesis 1:1 would tell you, God is the ultimate reality. All humanism is killing our young people, and it's producing men and women who think they are a God themselves, so they don't need the true and living God. Let's talk about evolution. It'll be the last one. Evolution, the denial of God as the creator. When you read the scripture and you study the biblical counts of generations, I believe the Bible will teach you that we have a young earth. I believe that you will find that the Bible will show you that the earth is somewhere under the age of 10,000 years. You will find, as you study the history of humanity, that evolution is a lie. It is not real. It is a theory. And it denies the deity, the eternality, and the creator that we call God. I just ask you a point blank question. You answer it in your own mind. Are you an evolutionist? If I was to ask you, how do you believe the world began? Where do you go? Well, Pastor, Satan is so smart. We don't want to be what we would consider to be normal evolutionists because we have some biblical understanding. So I'm a theistic evolutionist, which means that somehow God used process to create. God used time. God used evolutionary measures. The answer to that is no, he did not. How can you be so sure? He can't. There are some things God cannot do. And the number one thing that God cannot do is he cannot break his word. In six literal days, God created the world. To be an evolutionist is to deny God the glory of being the creator. Pastor, I don't really know where I fall on this. I listen to some people, they make a good argument. I listen to some people, they make a good argument. I don't know where I fall on this. Yeah, and that's why our churches are so weak. Stop listening to people and read the Word of God. Yeah. So much evolution is in our churches right now. Man. Oh, by the way, Genesis 1:1, God created all things. Every philosophy that has turned into a religion that explains how people act and how the world is so messed up is refuted in Genesis 1:1. No wonder the foundational verse. No wonder if you can believe that, you can believe the rest of the Bible. Together, please, one more time. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Amen? Let's pray. Next week, we'll move into creation. Father, the world is messed up because it's moved away from the truth of the Word of God. Now we believe there is no God. Or now we've substituted the creation for the creator, pantheism. Polyism, there can't just be one God. I can't submit to Jesus because if I submit to Jesus, I got to acknowledge myself a sinner and I don't want to do that. So let me have another God. Give me a God that I can be what I want to be and still be considered religious. Of course, then there's materialism. Living this life for the good, the things of this life. So if I don't have things, I'll steal from my neighbor. I'll murder my neighbor. I'm going to have those tennis shoes, whether you live about it or not. I'll kill you and take your tennis shoes. Materialism. Dualism. Well, there's a good God, there's evil God. no, there's one God. Humanism, I am a God. Good night. So I'm a God, and my morality is the starting point. And I'll live my life the way I want to live it. One day they'll meet the true and living God, and they will realize they are a human, they ain't a God. Evolutionism. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God. All of these philosophies are the religion of the world. Praise your holy name. And I get to preach to people today who have rejected the religion of the world and have received the Savior of the world. And we believe the Bible to be right. And we're on the side of the Bible. Strengthen us, God. Help us. Give us footing. I trust you for that, Lord. We love you and we thank you. Bless our time of invitation now. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand a moment for our invitation? Stretch your legs. Fix your clothes. Put your Bible away. That's usually how everybody stands up when I'm done preaching. It's really encouraging. Are you awake? Okay. So look me in my four eyeballs. If you died today, where would you go? Straight to heaven or straight to hell? One of the two places. The world will offer you a God. Any God you want. If you don't find one, be your own God. This book offers you the true and living God. That God will damn you. This God will save you. Have you accepted His Son as your Lord and Savior? If not today, you should come down. Tell Brother Hank, tell Brother Bill, tell Brother Simeon, I want to be saved. I want to accept the true and living God as my Savior. Christian, you were created for a wonderful purpose, to glorify God, to walk with God, to know God. I trust you're faithful in that. I don't want you to feel small today. I don't want you to feel lost today. I don't want you to feel separated today. God made you. God loves you. And God will care for you. He created you. Man, that's fantastic. He created the whole world out of nothing. He's big. Bring your problem and your need to Him. He'll care for you. Okay. Now we're ready to have an invitation. Just as I am, you come as God leads you.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee blood can cleanse each part, O Lamb of God, I come. come. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come. I come.
I gave homework in the 8:30 service. I want to give homework to you. Anybody remember He-Man? Master of the universe. My dad walked in one day when He-Man went, whoa, master of the universe. And I went, yeah. My dad said, turn that. Turn, Dad. Tommy, there's only one master of the universe, and that's Jesus. Now, I'm not telling you not to watch your, let your kids watch He-Man. I don't even know if it's on anymore. Everywhere around us are gods. So I want you just to be alert every time in the culture you hear God, gods, different types of gods. Listen for the philosophies of the culture. Be in tune with it. Turn your television on and watch the pantheism, polytheism, materialism, dualism, humanism, evolution. Just watch it come pouring out. And you will know that the world is worshiping a false god. Okay, just be alert to it. Because our God created all this out of nothing. Man, he's awesome. Okay, we have a camp meeting coming up. Next week is Father's Day. I probably will preach to the men. Ladies, you don't have to come. Just kidding about that. We'll take a break and come back. This is our little song. We sang it last week. We're singing it again. We're going to sing it at the end of every one of them. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead. He is Lord. God bless you. See you back on Wednesday.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
And God bless you all. You're not dismissed.